Morning and welcome to VivaTech Stage 5. My name is Kristen and I'll be leading you through our program today. We're going to be traversing FinTech, Energy and Smart Cities. We have some wonderful speakers, great panels for you today. If you've not already done so, please do download the app. There are a few program changes, so you can stay up to date and be sure to use the hashtag VivaTech when posting to social media. So we have a packed schedule. I'm going to crack on with our first panel, and I'm going to welcome to the stage John Egan from Anthemis. John's coming from the UK. We'll be leading our first panel on banking customer experience. John, over to you.
Good morning, everybody. Thanks for joining us this morning. So my name is John Egan. I'm from Anthemis Group. I'm based in London. Anthemis Group is the leading global financial innovation services firm, also the world's biggest fintech investor, and I lead our strategy practice. So this morning, we're going to have a conversation about customer experience in banking. And we've got three people on the panel. I'm going to ask them to come up now. We've got Sophie Heller from BNPP. We've got Nigel Vaz from Zebient. And we've got Jason Curtis from Personetics. So good morning, guys. I'm going to ask you to quickly introduce yourself to the audience, maybe take 30 seconds, and give a quick overview, name, role, and what you do on a day-to-day basis. Sophie?
So I'm Sophie Heller, hello. I'm CEO of Retail Banking and Services in BNP Paribas, and my job with my team is to help other countries accelerate the transformation in customer experience and invent new business models.
Hi, Nigel Vaz. I'm CEO of Sapient EMEA and APAC, and I lead our transformation practice locally.
Good morning, bonjour. I'm Jason Curtis from Personetics. I'm working in a European business development role, and we are a fintech providing solutions for increasing engagement in the digital channels to improve customer experience for banks.
Thanks, guys. So the panel name is, in a changing world, how can traditional companies adapt their customer experience fast enough to follow the pace of change? So the orientation here is a large organization in a highly regulated industry like banks in a very, very dynamic, shifting, fast-paced world with conflating technologies and adjacent industries pushing into it. How do we begin to manage and mitigate and seize the opportunity of customer experience? So we're going to start with some relatively easy questions and we'll scale up the difficulty as we go along, maybe. But if I can start with Sophie. Sophie, how has the customer experience evolved in banking over the last decade or so?
In the past? I must say that consumers in the banking industry are just like you and me. So as we are using more and more digital services, so we buy on Amazon, we rent our houses on Airbnb, we get used to many natural things. So we have personalized offers, we have alerting, we have fluid experience, multi-channels, and so all the customers are really expecting that as well from the bank. And the bank are not there yet, even though they are really doing some interesting move in alerting, for example, sending specific alerts before a payment is going to put you at risk, or sending personalized newsfeed to investors, for example, in Asia. So many things are already started to get up with new expectations, but the journey is only starting.
Okay, and Nigel, in your view, the key elements of a refined customer experience in today's world, what are they beginning to manifest as? What are the key trends you're seeing there?
I think if you look at, to your building on Sophie's point, if you look at the last probably 10 years or so, we've seen a lot of digitization of existing process. So I used to do something, I'm going to do exactly the same thing using a digital channel. And I think we're now starting to see the entire reimagination of both regulation and process. So somebody actually asking the question that says, do I really need a boarding pass to board an airline? Is there a different way? Do I need to walk into a bank to open a bank account? Do I need a card to take money out of an ATM machine? And I think this reimagination, to Sophie's point, is actually coming very much from the fact that pretty much all sectors, are seeing elements of their business be fundamentally reimagined by smaller competitors who are focused on just one aspect of the process. And you know, we've seen this in so many industries, and I think now, you know, banking is really going through a big transformation where the experience is the primary driver of transformation as opposed to the digitization of the existing process.
Cheers. Okay. And Jason, from a personal perspective, I mean, one thing we've kind of seen over the last couple of years is we moved from single channel banking experiences to multi-channel to omni-channel to, well, I suppose the question I'm getting to is, what does next generation customer servicing begin to look like? What does that experience evolve into? Are we beginning to see an integrated financial infrastructure where it's entirely interoperable?
Yeah, so from a Personetics perspective, so we saw an opportunity in the market we have a predictive analytics and artificial intelligence capability. And what we see is that customers want to receive more personalized guidance and advice when they're in the, regardless of which channel they're in, even when they're in front of an agent in a branch. And so what we learned is that if we were able to provide very personalized messages in the digital channels, and also to be able to provide information that's useful on a one-to-one basis. So if we don't try to sell them something, but we actually bring them a service, then the engagement level drastically rises and the customer satisfaction also rises tremendously. Obviously the loyalty to the bank remains very, very high.
Okay, so on that point then, Nigel, how is a bank meant to keep pace with that? An organization that takes a long time to make decisions typically, and for good reason as well, how does a large structure with very many different component parts begin to keep pace with that sort of decision-making process?
I think it starts with the fundamental orientation around the fact that the consumer journey or the customer journey is at the center of this process. And if you're not going to try and orient around that customer journey, you're going to see aspects of your business be disrupted. I think once that orientation is clear, I think it comes down to a few key things, and I'll hit on three of them. The first, I think, is a leadership and vision for what it is that you're trying to be for your customers. The second is not only retooling the tools and the technology, but also the culture and the management incentives. I think for me, you know, having a clear vision of where you're trying to go, recognizing that technology is now not a cost center, but is a fundamental ability to differentiate. And thirdly, recognizing that the incentives, the culture, and the way of working, so thinking about agile teams, cross-functional teams, focused on very small objectives, moving your orientation from the historical, what scope is this project trying to deliver, to how much value does this deliver, you know, focusing on productivity, not time. These sorts of shifts, I think, in the way of working are almost as critical as the vision you have to achieve it, because like you said, it's very hard to do.
Okay, that's it. So I'm still going to come back to you in a second. I'm going to go to Jason first and get both sides of this perspective. If you take what Nigel just said there, Jason, what are the key stumbling blocks or challenges that you guys have run into when working with banks?
Yeah, so there's a few different challenges. So from like a cultural standpoint, I would say that sometimes there's a little bit of resistance or employees even are skeptical about the ability of technology to increase engagement with customers without intervention from a human. So we've had very positive feedback from customers. We even had one of the biggest banks in the world in the US where the CEO and the CFO were involved in a pilot themselves, and they were very, very happy with the experience and the pertinence of the insights that we were pushing to them. So that was really useful in terms of changing mindsets from the top down. We also see in terms of sometimes challenges, obviously always having a little bit of a fragmented architecture in terms of channels and also in terms of data. So when we talk channels, obviously for us, what we try to do is we try to have a snapshot in real time of the current situation of the customer. In order to do that, we need to be able to connect the information from all of the interactions, regardless of which channel those interactions have taken place. And often that happens in multiple channels, because we like to call people in the call center, sometimes we go into the agent and the branch, and we do lots of stuff on our mobile phone. So fortunately, we have a technology which enables us to aggregate that information and to try to do that, but definitely banks are still, obviously, because they're incumbent, they're big, sometimes we have, they're still working in a more kind of siloed approach, and we're trying to break those silos and make it more transversal.
Okay, so Sophie, Jason touched on something there that I was going to ask you as well, because I think oftentimes when people think about startups working with large incumbent banks, there is a technology frustration. But is it really just a story of technology competence and capability within a large structure, or is there more to it as well?
No, I think it's much larger, of course, and to come up with Nigel's point, I think first of all, the transformation really is about the business transformation. So it's first a business transformation that is led by the CEO, and this is very important. This is not a marketing thing or an IT thing or a business thing. And then it's really about focusing on the customer experience. And in our case, we are really embracing this transformation from a customer journey perspective. The leadership is extremely engaged about the fact that the global and main KPI of the transformation is recommendation of the clients measured by the NPS. So this is already a very big sign of engagement from the top management saying this is this that we need really to move forward. So this is led by the CEO with a clear KPI which is focused on customer. This is about reorganization around customer journey, around new connected teams that work with empowerment and cross-functional. And this is, as has been also shared, is a huge change of mindset, at least on three dimensions that are, so customer obsession. Banks are not naturally on customer obsession. It's more product transaction based. So this is the first switch. Second switch is really from perfection to rapid test and learn. And this is also a very important cultural switch. And the third one is about really a more siloed and traditional management style to connected empowered teams. And I think that those changes are so profound that they can succeed only if really carried by the top leadership. So in our case, we have this leadership, which is really a key success factor. It doesn't mean it's easy, but this is the absolute precondition to success.
Do you see startups being a significant part of that change? And on building on that then, how is it a large bank like BNPP approaches working with companies that are so different in culture, in size and scale and capacity as well?
So two questions. The first question is, yes, we definitely see startups as an accelerator of this transformation because it helps the company move more quickly on the three challenges that I mentioned before. Second, it's also a journey. So we are starting to learn better with the startups. When we started a few years ago, we were not prepared. We didn't have the right connections. We didn't have the right even setup. So for example, 18 months ago, we've created an open up program, which is both an application that allows to connect the startups with project leaders inside BNP. So this is already make one door for startups and know who to talk to, which is already a big step for to help startups. And we've also simplified all the contracts, very clear guideline in terms of compliance, IT. So what are the conditions under which we can work with you, just to avoid that we are having startups losing time. So we know startups are very agile, but they also limited resources and time. So it's very important to be focused on finding the right person, make sure this is a priority in the bank and we are going to invest resources and find the right operational process to work. So this is a journey. Year after year, we have the hackathon. We can really see that we are learning to do that, and it's part of the huge cultural shift and mindset.
Jason, does that all ring true? Why did you guys decide to work with the bank? What was the motivation?
Yeah, so basically we're very focused on large banks, and we see that as what we see in the market, because we're working globally, some very big ones, is that the bigger banks, obviously they're a little bit threatened. They feel the threat of future entrance to the market, who are not necessarily banks. We all know about the GAFAs and also other digital banks which are arising. And obviously they want to to retain and look after their existing customer base, so they need to make a lot of effort in customer experience and customer service. They also have the resources and the motivation to do that. So for us, it's natural that we try to work with big banks, and definitely with the initiatives that big banks are taking, like Sophie's explained, this makes it much easier for us to work with a big bank. It's true that when we have top-down sponsorship, this really, really helps us. And from one of our experiences here in Europe, we have a dedicated person who's helping us to get known inside the group, because it's a galaxy and it's very difficult to navigate for a small company like us, even though we're already 100 people globally.
Yeah, makes sense. Nigel, if you take a step back, how do you see the relationship? It's not very old. The idea of a bank working with a startup is a novel and new concept. How do you see that evolving over time? Do you see it growing and expanding, or do you see a retrenchment by the banks potentially over time?
I think a couple things. So if you kind of just look at it broadly, like Sophie said, I think most large organizations are recognizing that there's a lot of knowledge to be gained from the startup community, but also value creation has to be something that exists on both sides. Our experience has been the challenge you have with any large organization going through a transformation journey beyond the things that we've already talked about are also at a fundamental level moving at the pace of change as a smaller organization expects. And then the other challenge I think you have, which you have to kind of really overcome, is there are some contradictions when you think about transformation. I mean, as an example, you know, Sophie's leading the transformation of BNP. We work with her team. And you look at a large organization like that, and the temptation at times is to say, we're going to boil the ocean. We're going to try and do lots of stuff, right? And you have to start small, and you have to start somewhere. But at the same time, the thing that you start small can't be throwaway in the orientation of we've just tried it, it's proof of concept, and somebody else is doing something else. So you're trying to basically get small things going and deliver value quickly, but at the same time, what you're trying to do is scale a set of best practices that can be leveraged across, not just cultural best practices, but technological best practices, or Sophie said, procurement best practices, whatever they are, to create almost a kind of platform-like ecosystem. So where I think this is being done well is you almost imagine the larger organization like a platform, creating a set of docking stations or APIs, allowing various entities to plug in and plug out. Now, that's a lot harder to do than it is to say it as a concept, because it involves building an interface into every level of the organization to work a different way than they used to. And I think that's a big part of why some of these relationships don't work, because the startup's got 5 people, they're looking to add value quickly, and they find that it's not that they can't necessarily address the problem, it's that they get bogged down in all of the process around that before they ever get to doing that. And I think, you know, unless you try and figure out how to create a model, and Sophie's talked about a kind of fast-track approach, you know, going through that is a big aspect of that.
So the process is shaping the proposition rather than the other way around.
Yep.
Just checking, can everybody hear us okay, yeah? My Irish accent isn't causing any problems. No, we're good. Okay, so we've talked now for the last 15 minutes or so about the way customer experience in banking is evolving. What we haven't really touched on is the core of that statement, which is, what is an ideal customer experience in banking? I definitely have some thoughts on it, but I'd love to hear what you guys think as well. Does anybody want to take that first? What's an ideal customer experience in banking, Jason?
I'll give you my opinion on what I'd like to receive from my bank. So basically, I want to be able to receive personalized advice and help from my bank to guide me, regardless of where I am, whether I'm in a digital channel, whether I'm face-to-face, and basically just to kind of alert me if there's an issue. If they can do that proactively, then that's much better, obviously. And to be available to help me if there's an issue, to help me to help myself to resolve that thing with a little friction and effort if possible. And obviously if I can't do that myself, then obviously to help me to put me in contact with a human so I can actually speak to someone and get help.
I think from my perspective, you know, customer experience in banking is very simply taking out the friction from the things you don't necessarily want to deal with. I don't think most people wake up every day and say, today I'm going to engage with my bank. And it's not necessarily, you know, like you just, that's not something you want to do. So you want to figure out what it is that customers want to do and how is it that you are enabling that. So I'll give you a couple of examples. You know, Most big cities, many of us live in big cities, you go find a house you want to buy. You go to the house, you walk in, you look at it, it's great, you want to buy it. Now you've got to go to your bank, fill out a bunch of paperwork, they'll assess whether or not you can get a mortgage against that house. By the time you get an answer, guess what, that house is gone, right? Now that's a very common problem that so many of us see. Why couldn't I actually get a mortgage while standing in the apartment and help the bank, whether it's through machine learning or robotic process automation or streamlining their own process, to give me an answer which otherwise would take them 11 days, take 4 minutes. Like, that's something we've helped build. And that makes a huge difference in my life as a customer. Similarly, like I said, why do I have to go into a bank to open a bank account when I don't go into an Apple store to open an iTunes account? What is the difference? There shouldn't be. So these are just some pet peeves.
As a customer, what I'm dreaming of is, as an ideal customer experience, is really to have it completely proactive and personal. So basically, I want two things, I think. I want to be notified where I need it to make the right decisions. For example, I've decided to restrain a little bit my restaurant expenses, okay? I've set up a budget. It's Friday night, I'm about to maybe plan for dinner and maybe have another saying, in case you're thinking of going out, I just remind you that you overspent your limit. Or, this is Friday, usually you send money to your daughter, Julie, who lives in the UK. You haven't done that. Do you want me to do it for you? So in that case, I really want to take out the pain and the time to look after all those things so I can really focus on what is trending in my life. So this is the first thing. And the second thing, I think, is really that the bank answers to my simple and complex questions in a conversational manner. So, can I afford this trip in Brazil in 2 months? And get really the answer in a very natural way? Or more complex questions like, what do I do if I want to retire in 10 years and move to Corsica and do kitesurfing? Okay. What should I do? And maybe in that case, I need start a discussion where the bank is going to test a few hypotheses and then say, okay, why don't we meet in 2 days, place convenient for you with an advisor that is going to set some options for you. So as a benefit, I really want to have the security that I'm not going to find myself in something, in trouble because I forgot something, so take the pain out. And at the same time, help me explore options that are interesting for my life. I think this is really how I see ideal banking.
I think that's fantastic, Sophie, because I think that's the journey from being able to react to what customers want quickly to being able to anticipate. And I think that shift is a big one, because so much of what people in banks do in the historical situation where there's long relationships and I know you is bringing the context of your situation into a conversation with you about things. And actually, the ability to leverage technology, not only to replace people, but to enable people to be smarter. Another example in banking, not on the retail side, but for example, in the investment management or wealth management side, or in the or even in the investment banking side, is how quickly, like Sophie's saying, can you visualize and give me a set of decisions on a large data set that historically just wasn't possible in order to enable a specific action? Because everybody's talking about data and the value of data, but the value of data is only good to the extent that you can use it in this moment to answer whether she can go kite surfing in 10 years or not. And if you can't, then frankly, it doesn't matter how much data you have on me because you're not able to bring it to bear at this moment. And I think a lot of the data usage in banks has been retrospective or historical, and I think more and more it's going to need to be predictive and hypothesis oriented as opposed to reactive.
So I think we're all pretty aligned on that, and I'm sure the audience are as well. So anybody who disagrees with that or hears that vision of banking and says, no, actually, I would much prefer a branch-oriented customer experience, everybody's kind of aligned that this vision of the future of banking where you don't buy a mortgage, you buy a home, is particularly important. Why? What are the blockers? Because it feels like now for the last 36 months, we've all been aligned, consultants and investors and banks and startups. We all know where this is going. We all know where customers want to be. Why are we incapable of getting it there? Or is it just a case of, this is moving a glacier, it takes time?
I think it takes time and it's complex. And as we say, we are tackling a lot of different issues, IT systems and type of management, organization, different set of priorities, and but we are getting there. So we are progressively choosing KPI that are operational, focus on the customer. We measure also what are the main pain points now for the customer, so we are able also to prioritize our plans according to that. We are experimenting, we are working with autonomous teams, so this is not spread completely across all the organization, but we have all the ingredients in place. We need to accelerate that.
I think it's, you know, a large part of it comes down to us as consumers too, you know, because I think for the longest time, if you ask people what was important in a bank, it was trust, security, and all of those things are very important, right? But that was in a world where the bank was primarily your safety deposit box, where it held your physical assets. More and more, I've seen a trend, and there's a lot of new data that says when younger people pick banks today, the most important thing to them is the experience. Far outstripping, because they're just assuming you're going to keep my money safe. That's table stakes. I don't, you know, you're not doing anything incredible by doing that.
Also because they have no money, so the experience is all
over. Yeah, that's true. Yeah, that is true. But I think the experience is pretty critical, because I think the minute that becomes a defining factor, I think you start to see the same thing that happens. You know, banks historically used to talk about switching cost. The switching cost of banks was the highest of any sector, second only to utilities, because people just thought it was such a hassle to change my bank. But you know, if you look at what's happening in certain sectors of the market, in certain geographies, more bank accounts are being opened outside of the traditional banking institutions, because really, what am I trying to do? Save some money, wire some money, pay some bills? And a lot of those functions, if you're going to deliver them to be easier, quicker, faster, then that becomes a determination. And the reason I answered your question from a consumer's point of view as opposed to from a bank's point of view, because Sophie is right, it takes a long time and it is moving because it takes a while. But the thing that really makes organizations change is a clear message from the consumer. And I think when your consumers really send you a clear message that this is not necessarily how we want to do business, you have business models, you know, in so many other sectors that have demonstrated that kind of shift is possible much faster than you thought it was a year ago.
Yeah, a stat that backs up that point. I know in the UK, the average marriage lasts 11 years, but the average bank account lasts 24. And I think that's kind of relevant, because maybe the most significant thing happening in European banking right now is the general movement towards an open banking infrastructure through the consensus-based approach to regulatory development, PSD2, MiFID2, IFRS9, GDPR, and ultimately, I think, the Capital Markets Union as well, which is going to internalize wholesale funding for banks. This is all part of a movement and a trajectory towards open infrastructure. So that inevitability maybe of interoperability, it probably does two things, and I'd love to hear your view on this. One is, it creates an enormous opportunity for banks, because there's a significant head start there and the infrastructure is in situ. But it also provides an opportunity for adjacents. And if I look at Amazon, for instance, who did $1 billion in SME lending quietly and stealthily last year, and they're now up to $3 billion in SME lending without people realizing, that's an obvious, that is a space that I think banks are going to feel very threatened by quite quickly. So how much time do we have? And it seems to me, and Sophie, I'm really curious to hear your view on this. PSD2 in particular seems to have a lot of banks in a wait and see mode to a degree. Let's see how this plays out. Let's see what it looks like. Let's see how startups respond or who the requests come from, because we don't have a view of the landscape yet. So do banks have the luxury of time? And if they do, what do you think that interoperable environment begins to look like?
A difficult question. I think certainly we look at the openness as both a regulatory issue but also an opportunity. By the way, the bank also has started like 3 years ago to open and create some APIs to be able to either export the services, for example, financing in car dealers, so this is something that we already do, or we incorporate services through APIs in our system. So we are definitely engaged into this openness. I think that coming back to the customer experience, this is about how fast are we able to evolve towards this ideal customer experience that we mentioned, because of course, as a customer, you can pick up and choose many products from the digital different players, but at the end of the day, the question I have how do I retire in 10 years to look at surfing, or can I afford this, requires to have a holistic view of my finance. So I really do believe that there's still absolutely relevance for the bank to occupy that, and this is survival to occupy that. But it doesn't mean that pieces and bits of the value chain will be taken also by startups in the meantime. I think we'll see both.
I mean, from our perspective, we're leading a couple of the big open banking and implementations and technology and cultural implementations from a European perspective. And the one big recognition is that regulation potentially now is moving faster than historically the banks themselves had actually moved. So for the first time, we're seeing really progressive regulation around opening up financial data in order to do exactly what Sophie's saying. Because if you take it one step further, it's not just my financial data doesn't just sit with one bank or one institution. It's a data passport. You know, I mean, the whole eventual vision from a customer experience perspective of, you know, where the scenarios, you know, what MiFID, PSD2 that you laid out gets to, I think, is me saying, this is my data, and I want to combine it in such a way with these institutions to answer these questions. And if you think about it as very much a data passport that we can plug in to these institutions to answer this question, and then plug in to another institution to answer a different question, allows me that choice. And to Sophie's point, if you are not able to provide me that answer and that service, somebody will. And I think banks today are extraordinarily well positioned because they have trust with the consumer, but they've then got to deliver on the experience behind that trust.
Okay, so we are coming to the conclusion of this session. If I could ask you guys, each of you, to very quickly, and Jason, maybe we'll start with you. What one feature would you like to add to your banking experience as a customer of banking, given what you see in the space? What's the one thing you'd like banks to be able to do for you?
It always comes back to the same theme, basically having the bank anticipating my needs and being able to advise, give me qualified, personalized advice.
Perfect. Nigel?
I think becoming a trusted partner and advisor.
Perfect.
I'd be very concrete. For example, managing all the warranties or all the products that you buy is really a pain. So I'd like my bank to be able to store all my contracts, my warranties, and when my vacuum cleaner doesn't work, I can already know if it's under warranty or not. I want also my bank to tell me, oh, you have some overlapping in your insurance coverage, things that are very concrete like this and helps me take decisions.
Okay, well, that is the conclusion of our session. Thank you very much to the panelists. And thank you as well to the audience. Thank you very much.